Hear these words of Scripture. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, says the Spirit. They will rest from their labors, and their deeds follow them. Friends, we have gathered here today to celebrate the life of Lenora Norwood Fincher and to witness to the resurrection and claim the promises of the resurrection for her. Lenora was a wife, mother, aunt, sister, friend, but she was more than all of that. She was a child of God, and it is in her loving memory that we gather today. Let us pray. Eternal God, we bless you for the great company of all those who have kept the faith, finished their race, and who now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially, we thank you for Lenora Norwood Fincher, whom you have now received into your presence. Help us to believe where we have not seen, trusting you to lead us through our years. Bring us at last with all your saints into the joy of your home through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Dolores has chosen several scriptures today that seem to speak to her mother and her faith. Our first is Micah 6, verses 6 through 8. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? We've also chosen Psalm 23 and invite you to recite with me this familiar and comforting Psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And then from the epistles, from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. Looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such hostility against himself from sinners, so that you may not grow weary or lose heart. And from the Gospel according to John chapter 14, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Right now, one of heaven's newest residents is digging her hands in the rich soil, planting her garden and deciding what she will plant where. She won't have to worry about rainfall or bugs or nightfall coming before she's got her seeds in the ground. Lenora knows she's going to have a magnificent garden this year. She's been greeted by her husband, Bill, as well as her brothers and her parents and others who have gone before. And now she gets to work in her garden again. In many ways, Lenora Fincher was ahead of her time. She was born at the end of the flu pandemic in 1918 and lived through the COVID pandemic, although she didn't get to see its end. She did, though, get to see women gain the right to vote, which happened shortly after her birth. I can't imagine everything she has seen. And although she probably wouldn't call herself a feminist, she was a strong woman who worked hard to achieve her goals provide for her family, and make a better life for her daughter and her husband. Lenora was many things. She was a wife, a mother, a daughter, sister, aunt, friend. But first, she was a child of God, created in the image of God. She was not the kind of person to talk about her faith, but she lived it quietly in the way that she treated others. She modeled the saying, "Preach a sermon every day, and if necessary, use words." Today, we confuse strength with being hard or tough. But Lenora lived a life of strength that, as the scriptures were said, we read, said, persevered in the race that was set before her, overcoming barriers to achieve her goals. But she also didn't put her goals above relationships with the people in her life. She lived her life and her faith with integrity. No matter the circumstances, we are never ready to say goodbye to someone we love. It's amazing that she was just short of her 102nd birthday. She lived a long and full life, and it's never quite enough, though. So today, as we gather to remember Lenora, we gather in sorrow and grief for our loss. But we also gather knowing that her days of labor and struggle are over. She has joined the great cloud of witnesses and taken her place among the communion of saints. She now resides in a place of perfect peace in the arms of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the promise of Christ that is made for all who believe. "Do not let your hearts be troubled," our Lord tells us. "In him, all who believe will abide with God forever, and all will find rest and peace. In this we find our hope." So although we gather today in mourning, we gather with hope for a better day. We know there's a more perfect day to come when there will be no more tears, when there will be no more suffering, when there will be no more pain. So now as we say goodbye to Lenora, we bid her peace and safe passage into the arms of her Savior, Christ Jesus. And we can praise God for the hope that one day we'll be together again. And let us seek the consolation in the love of God that never ceases. To God be all honor, glory, and praise. Amen. And now John Norwood and Dolores Learmont have some memories and stories to share with you. John?
Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us this afternoon. I'm John Norwood. My Aunt Lenora was my great aunt. Very special person to me because she was the last closest thing I had to my granddad, Haywood, who was very special to me. We had a tremendous relationship growing up and throughout my life. And he would often speak fondly of her and tell me stories about the old times and, you know, while she was living. He was still living for me as well. All right, so some good stories about her and my father. My father went to Chapel Hill and was very excited to go. Did not have a lot of money. Got prepared to go up there, and Aunt Lenora noticed that he did not have, he was packed up in paper grocery bags and boxes for his things he was taking to school. And so she said, "Okay, we got to fix this." So she bought him a suitcase So he could properly go to school in the suitcase and come to school in a respectable, good way. I thought I knew about that, and I thought about that again when I was at school. I don't remember what kind of suitcase I had. I'm sure it was something just fine. I noticed a young man and what looked to be his grandparents coming in from the countryside, and he had his belongings in a paper bag and boxes. And this was, you know, in the early 90s. So I'll always remember the suitcase story. Another good story is that Aunt Lenora, as we all know, weddings weren't her favorite thing to go to. So after my parents got married, she gave a very generous gift of $100. And that $100 was very much needed because my dad was starting his law practice at that time. And so that $100 went toward it was the exact price for the material and labor of reupholstering a very nice sitting chair that was in his office and stayed in his office throughout his entire career. And I now have that that same chair with that same upholstery in my office at home, and it's sitting right in front of my dad's desk that I use just about every day at home. And oftentimes I'll still sit in that chair, which is actually between my desk and my wife's desk in our home office. So I think of her every time I sit in that chair. Last story that, you know, my mom had a very difficult breast cancer situation quite some time ago. And when the surgery happened, my dad was waiting alone. It turned out to be an 8-hour surgery. Who came in but Aunt Lenora? No one knew she was going to come in. My dad was sitting there alone. The surgery was 8 hours. She stayed with him the entire time and was with him that entire time. And he always remembered how kind she was and what she sacrificed that day and just being there for him during you know, one of the lowest and most difficult moments of his life. She was there for him. But there are probably so many more stories like this, many stories that very few people even know, because everything she did, she seemed to do in a very discreet way. She was kind, and she was there. She just knew what to do, and she never made a fuss or a big deal about it. She just gave of herself. She even made a connection with the most the youngest of all of the relatives. My niece Emma Jackson's my sister's daughter. Emma made this special poster for her over Christmas that hung in her room at Sharon Towers. I love you, great great Aunt Lenora. You are amazing. Love, Emma. And I don't know how many people can say they have a great-great aunt, but that's pretty darn rare. But even a connection with Emma. But, you know, when I think of Aunt Lenora, nurturing, compassionate, and thoughtfulness are the things that really come to my mind. It's been a pleasure to share some memories and of Aunt Lenora and what she meant to our family. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, John. And thank all of you for being here with Bill and me to celebrate the life of my mother, Lenora Dolores Norwood Fincher. Yes, you heard that right. I got her middle name. As I have reflected over the past few days on how I can best share with you some observations about the wonderful person I was fortunate enough to call mother for close to 8 decades, Three words have come to mind that capture the essence of the person we have all come to know and love and frankly be in awe of. First, determination. I'm looking to see recognition. Her mindset was this: any worthwhile goal was achievable if you are willing to work long enough and hard enough to accomplish it. It simply could be done with enough work and enough time. And of course, you had to save a little bit out of every dollar you made and set it aside for accomplishing more in the future. She would have reminded me of that. And her whole life was a demonstration of that principle. She never gave up. Never. She may have had to withdraw a little, but she always came back, and she accomplished, in my opinion, amazing things over her lifetime with that approach. Whether it was playing guard on Jackson High School's 1936-37 Union County champion girls basketball team, or growing an array of roses beautiful and plentiful enough to provide flowers for her daughter and son-in-law's wedding, or astounding the physical therapy staff at Sharon Towers at her ability to spring back from numerous falls sustained over the last 5 to 6 years of her life by putting in the work to do even more exercises and for more repetitions than they even asked. She flat out knew the price and the value of old-fashioned hard work. Second, courage. I suppose that one of the inevitable things about living to the age of 101 is encountering quite a few disappointments and losses. I also think that it takes courage to keep those losses and disappointments from consuming or destroying you. Over the past 30 years, Mother has lost her husband, 3 of her brothers, and a great many beloved friends, relatives, and neighbors who meant a great deal to her. She has grieved those losses, but somehow found a way to stay focused on the future and how she could live a meaningful life going forward despite those losses. Then there was her battle with the Charlotte Douglas International Airport to keep her home from being taken for airport expansion. She fought long and hard to keep her home, and especially her yard full of flowers and the vegetable garden that she had lovingly cared for over 50 years. But when she lost that battle, and she did, that was one of the objectives that she couldn't overcome, one of the obstacles that she couldn't overcome, she refused to let the airport defeat her. She simply moved to a patio home in Monroe and proceeded to plant a yard and a garden full of as many flowers and plants as she possibly could. That would show the Charlotte airport that they couldn't take that away from her. And she gained a lot of respect and admiration from her neighbors in Monroe, I think, for having done just that. Finally, my last word that my mother reminds me of, or that reminds me of my mother, is love. My mother's capacity for love of her family and her friends seemed to be unlimited. And you all here gathered know exactly what I'm talking about. She adored her parents and her brothers, and she always made sure to spend time with them, feed them, that was always necessary, and supply them with anything they might need or that she might think they needed, as long as she could afford it. Mother and Daddy shared a special kind of love that comes from working together to achieve common goals, and they always had some fun along the way. As the object of one of her of As the object of some of her most intense affection, I can testify to the power and effectiveness of her unconditional love, tempered, of course, with her understanding that setting standards and imposing discipline were critical components of that love. You've heard from John today some very wonderful examples of how much she loved her nieces and nephews and everybody in her family. And I would also mention that she loved with equal vigor the friends acquaintances that she came across in her long life. And those folks have spoken eloquently to me of acts of love that she gave that nobody knows about, just as John said. She didn't make a big point of saying, see what a difference I made in somebody's life. She just went about making the difference. So these are reflections on some of the most unforgettable qualities of a remarkable woman from a loving and grateful daughter. I think it's fair to say that Mother's life was a life well lived, worthy of admiration and our emulation. Thank you again for sharing this time with us.
You may be seated. I invite you to bow your heads in prayer with me. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially, we thank you for your servant, Lenora Norwood Fincher, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of her life, for all in her that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave her that kindled in her the love of your dear name and enabled her to serve you faithfully. We thank you for Lenora's strength and determination, for her work ethic that helped Dolores and her family have more opportunities. She was in many ways ahead of her time for the role women had in the workforce, and we thank you for that. We thank you that for her, death is past and pain ended, and that she has now entered the joy you have prepared through Jesus Christ our Lord. We ask that you hear us as we pray as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your child, Lenora Dolores Norwood Fincher. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Now, if you are able, I invite you to stand and join in singing, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.
Thank you.
And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, remain with you always. Amen.